Pastor Ben mentioned a few minutes ago that we started a new series last week called Made for Mission. And if you're especially new to exploring the claims of Christ, haven't even yet stepped into a walk with Christ, this might be a topic where you say, well, I don't know if that one's for me. And I would just say this to you, it's for everybody. Because God created you, God has plans for you, He has a purpose for you, and part of the purpose involves mission. And there's things inside of you that once you know Jesus, they come alive and He puts them into use. And it doesn't mean that you can't be productive before that or even enjoy things before that, but you'll never feel or do what God wants you to do without a relationship with Him. He literally, we talk about new life. You can have physical life and then not have the life of Christ living in you. And you can accomplish things in this world, even go and enjoy a lot of things in this world, and it'll always feel like something's missing. Well, that something missing is not only Jesus, but His purpose for our lives and the mission that He has for us. And so be open to seeing what the Lord wants to say to you, regardless of whether you're just starting out or you've been in this thing a long time. Today, I want to take it a step forward and talk about being ready for mission. Being ready for mission. How many know there's a difference between being responsible for something and being ready for something? Like you were given a task, but you weren't ready for it. So you got a responsibility, but you weren't quite ready. In a word that's, by the way, called parenting. Is this not true? Like that baby comes, you're responsible. You're not fully ready. No parent fully understands the scope of what they just got themselves into. And you can celebrate parenting your whole life, and then you know you're in over your head your whole life too. And I actually think that God created babies that way to remind us we need God. Every baby, you can look at the baby and say, there's a God, and then look at the baby and say, and I need Him. I need help. I don't know what responsibility I just undertook, but I don't think I'm equipped for everything that's going to arise in this child's life. I need God. Well, it also plays out in a work setting. There are people who've been given a responsibility who aren't ready, and when they're not ready long enough, they get fired. True? So I was given a job, but I just couldn't show up on time. I was given a job, but I just didn't do my part. I was given a responsibility, but I wasn't ready for it. And so then somebody had to take my place and I'm gone and somebody else is there. Ever seen these on the internet, these little photos most of the time that says at the top, he had one job. Seen any of these? If you haven't seen them, I'll just give you a couple just for fun. He had one job, right? Apparently on the way to the school spelling bee. He just got in a hurry right there. I like this next one. This is classic. You got to read what's on the side of the truck. Take your time, all right? You'll get there. There might not have been any shortcuts, but he was trying. You got to give him credit for that. And then this is an awesome one. Somebody did their job, they just did not do it right. And the only redeeming thing I can think is if it's a husband and wife, she'll never wake up in the middle of the night and ask him, did you close the door to the patio? Okay, you don't have to worry about that one. But in our walk with Jesus, we've been given a responsibility called a mission. We have to get ready. It's not automatic. And so I want to take you to a story today that I think can help us. It gives some great insight into some of the things that we could get ready for. It's in Acts chapter 3. Let me read a little bit of it first and then highlight some things that when I open up God's word and I look at a story and I say, God, speak to me, I'm just going to share some of the things that challenged me with this story. Acts chapter 3. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple to pray at 3 in the afternoon. So they're going to do a good thing. They're going to go pray. Now, a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. I've always thought there's a little bit of an irony here that you would take the crippled guy and put him under the sign called Beautiful. That he would have to do a non-beautiful thing all day long to try to capture the attention and hearts of people while sitting under this particular heading. It says that when Peter and John were about to enter, he asked them for money. And can we not all picture this even today? There's versions of this today. And there's mental dialogue that tends to go with it. I wonder if this is just a scam. I wonder if he just doesn't want to work. I wonder if I give him money, if he'll misuse it and abuse himself even more because of something I gave him. Well, I give elsewhere. I don't have any money today. I'll do it later. I mean, it's just not all things that you and I have said in our mind when we see people in this situation. Well, on this particular day, it says this, that Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave him his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them to the temple, into the temple courts, and I love this part, walking and jumping and praising God. Wouldn't you? Come on, you haven't been on these things your whole life, and now all you're gonna do is walk? No, you're gonna check him out. He's walking and leaping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were all filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened. If you're newer to the Bible or just want to get more proficient at what you read in the Bible so that your understanding rises higher, let me give you just a word today that will help you that I constantly ask, and the word is why. Why is this story here? Because in this particular case, the book of Acts is going to go on for about 30 years. Think about all of the things that could have wound up in the storyline of the book of Acts that didn't make it into the storyline of the book of Acts. So when stories wind up in there, I just stop by saying, why this one? What's unique about this story? Because the stories are historically real stories, but they're also windows into the ways of God. They're either going to tell you something about God or they're going to tell you something about his ways. And so they tend to be frameworks for you to see more, especially to translate it from 2,000 years ago to your world and to my world. So why is this story here? Well, when you ask the question, you're not going to get a right answer. There's not like one right answer. What you're going to get is a mind that's ready to receive something from the Lord. Because when you just say, "Lord, open up to my mind why you put this in here. Why is it here? Because I would love to have not just a moment of time where I'm reading your word. I want to have a moment of time where I feel like you spoke to me through it." And so I want to share a few of the things that I feel like God said to me. Here's number one. The upper room is the fueling station. Say fueling station. For the mission on the streets. Quick Bible study tool for you to also ask is, and what's the context? Because a lot of times what you read is sitting in a context. Sometimes when it comes to the stories of Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, or even the book of Acts, which are all storylines, the previous story may or may not be connected. But if it's connected in some way, it'll actually give some insight into that particular story. Well, all we got to do, because this is chapter 3, is back up a chapter or two. So looking at chapter 1 and 2, you also find these two same people. You find Peter and John. They're in an upper room with about 110 or so people in an upper room, and they're doing what Jesus told them to do, which is to wait for the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit was going to come on them and fill them so that they could do their mission. It was called be a witness. And that the Holy Spirit was going to help them with that. And so that's why they're there. And what takes place in an upper room is preparation for the streets. And there's a connection between the two. And what I've seen over the years are people who don't spend enough time in the upper room thinking they can fulfill their mission without God's help. Or more so what happens is if you don't spend enough time in the upper room, you don't tend to think about mission. That's what I've discovered. But when I've spent some time with God and his Holy Spirit is working in my life, now I feel like I'm walking out of that room with a greater awareness that God's up to something. And so I'm not supposed to just seek him, I'm supposed to share him. The two of these things go together. Think about the upper room like a fuel station. So today, you know, it could be electric cars, and so you're going to that, you know, new electric area, or you're going to the gas pump. But the fueling station is not the destination. It's the fuel to take you to your destination, right? If you get up in the morning and say, I think today I'm just going to go to the gas station. All day. Tomorrow, I'm going to go again, just to top it off. And the next day, I'm going to go again. All of us would say, well, you're not understanding the purpose. Like it's valuable, you must have it. Your car needs it to move forward, but it's the fuel station for the destination. Can I say this about the upper room and the streets? You need fuel for the streets, but you need to also understand that the upper room isn't the final mission. It's the launch pad for the mission. I've met Christians over my lifetime who have neglected one or the other of those. Too many people that don't spend enough time with God, and too many people that all they want to do is spend time with God. Have another Bible study, have another prayer meeting, have another whatever, and we're gathering with Christians, and Christians sit and soak. You need both. Chapter 3 is in the Bible because of chapter 2. Chapter 3 is in the Bible because they didn't just keep coming back to chapter 2, there was a mission. And so once you understand the context, you read a story like this and you say, Lord, thank you that you put this in the Bible because I need both. I need to lean in to what God has for me, and then I need to leave that to go out and do what you want to do through me. I need both of these. Last Sunday, we had something called a miracle night, and this is our time to lean in. So we can accomplish a certain amount of things on a Sunday morning, but the part where I feel like the people of God really lean in and linger and spend a little bit more time, and we literally even talked about the Holy Spirit's power on our lives to get us ready for mission, those nights are important. And some of you missed it, and so what we're gonna do all year long, 2023, is we're gonna have more of these so that if you happen to be gone on one, you can get the next one. And hopefully you'll keep picking up on others, because we need what God wants to do in us when we gather and lean in. And then we're gonna go out different. We're gonna go out different. And point number two. A divine appointment is often disguised as an inconvenient interruption. Say interruption. I need to listen for the Holy Spirit's prompting. Anybody with me on not being a big fan of interruptions? Like you get going on your task, and it's there, and you're moving forward, and every person that comes in is an interruption along the way. Well, you know what? Some of those interruptions are actually divine appointments just disguised as an interruption. I want God to use me, but for a long time, I just wanted God to check with me first. God, could we coordinate calendars? I want to be used of you, but I need it to be on a convenient time according to my schedule. And what I've discovered is mission doesn't always happen in a convenient time. I've discovered mission often happens in an inconvenient time, during an interruption. It's interesting that the Bible tells us that Peter and John were on their way to a prayer service. And it literally gives a detail, 3 p.m. Why is that there? Just to remind us that it was an appointment. And if they were like most good Christians that I know, if it started at 3, it's 3:05 and they're not there. And they've missed the welcome. They've missed the opening song. Now they're wondering if they should just delay and come during friendship break and sneak in as if all the previous things never even happened. You didn't know that was in the book of Acts. I'm trying to help you out today. Well, maybe I'm making a little bit of this up, but I think it could have happened that on the way there, Peter and John are running a little late, and Peter's even saying, John, come on, pick up the pace a bit, buddy. They've already started the service, and then all of a sudden, a guy who's been there every day catches their attention. If he's been there every day, and they probably prayed repeatedly, why didn't they notice him on previous days? Because for whatever reason, on previous days, he wasn't the mission. Do you know on the way to prayer, they probably passed hundreds of people that also weren't the mission? Do you know it's okay to pass by a lot of people during the middle of a day? on your way to something, and that's okay. But what you really want to do is have spent enough time in the upper room to be tuned in to know the difference between what's an interruption and what's a divine appointment. And somehow these guys made eye contact, and that seems to be the thing that didn't happen at the Gate Beautiful. Because even in today's world, you can see something but then want to not be seen yourself. This is what we do in today's world. If I see you but I don't want you to see me, I will pull out my cell phone and act like it's a long-lost lover. Stare into it like we're having a meaningful conversation. Now I'm sending signals out to all of you, just leave me alone, I'm doing something else. If you really want to double down, you put earbuds in. Because that now is the universal sign to say, I'm in my own circle, don't bother me. Well, Peter and John don't have cell phones and they don't have earbuds and they don't know the 21st century rules that you can ignore people. They did just been tuned in by the Holy Spirit, and somehow when they make eye contact on this particular time, when they see him, they see him. And there's a difference when the Holy Spirit is prompting you to say, well, there's a whole bunch of people there because I've been to Jerusalem before. The roads even today are narrow down those streets. You can pass 100 people and not necessarily see them. But when the Holy Spirit prompts you, now it looks different. And even though they're on their way to a good thing, a prayer meeting, God is going to interrupt their prayer meeting for mission. And this guy is their person on that day. And they take a few moments and they connect with him. Again, I want to underscore, you just got to be tuned into the Holy Spirit, because most of the time, you actually need to show up on time. That's actually a good thing. If you work for a company and you're wanting to make influence on those coworkers around you, you actually need to earn your credibility by doing your responsibility. Now you've got something to say. But if you're the one that's constantly late, or you're the one that doesn't do the job as strongly or as wholeheartedly as somebody else, you don't have street cred with them to actually then do what God wants you to do. And so these things do go in together. Well, in this particular case, here's a guy that God wants to interrupt their schedule. It's not really going to affect what's going on in the service. I don't think they were on the speaking list or anything that day. They just had to get over the fact that they were busy and on their way somewhere. One of the most common things that'll keep you from mission is your to-do list. And all of us have one in some form or another. And all of us truly can get to the place where our to-do list is more important than everything else. Can I give you a practical application for today that truly, different times I feel like I have to be more intentional about it. So as I'm doing this message, I'm just making a public commitment to you. I'm making it all more intentional all over again, that I want to get to a place where when I get up in the morning, I'm not praying for God to bless my agenda. I'm praying for awareness to be on his. And there is a difference. I can say, God, my day is full. I got all kinds of stuff. Just help me get through the day and do what I need to do. I can pray that prayer. That's a good prayer. But I'm telling you, a better prayer is to say, God, I want to put you first. You're the agenda. I know you know I have some responsibilities. I need your help with them. But ultimately, I'm praying that you would help me do your will all day long. And I believe this, if you actually are interrupted somewhere in your day and you give somebody 3 minutes or 5 minutes or even have to take a lunch break and you take an hour with the person, God will make up the time. God has an ability to multiply things. And I believe he can multiply time. When you put him first, the Bible says, seek him first and all these other things will be added. Rather than feeling overwhelmed all day long, why don't you just say, God, today I'm giving you my schedule. You know what I need to get done. I think he'll actually help you get things done. I think he'll help you be more productive. And then you'll be tuned in case he wants to interrupt you somewhere for somebody who needs you that day. I know you're busy, but more important than busyness is called mission. There are people that need Christians that will slow down and make eye contact. Can I encourage you with one more thing today? I'm going to practice this all month long too with you. Go out in public and put your phone away. First of all, see what it's like to not have it in your hand, because you'll feel like you don't even know what to do anymore. You know, some of you are just nervous people and it's like it's not there, and it's like you'll be thinking about it all day and then you'll realize, I have not made eye contact with hardly anybody lately. And as I said a few minutes ago, many of the people are not the mission for the day. They're just people to be nice to or people that pass by and, you know. But if God wants to use you, I don't think he can use you if you're not tuned in. And sometimes it is the eye contact that makes the difference. You might have heard me say this before, but Crystal's remarkably good at this in grocery stores. I tend to go to the grocery store for one reason, to get out there out of it the fastest I can. I want to get up and down the aisles, I want to fill the cart, and I want to find the lady who, or the man who is the fastest in line. So I'm an admitted, you know, task-oriented, get through this thing. And she comes up, and she is just, she's got one sentence. I've heard her do it 100 times. So how's your day? In such a way that's not a cliche. I've seen cashiers stop their work when somebody took note of them. She'll compliment them for something. In all the full disclosure, she's never led anybody to the Lord in Safeway. All right? No prayer meetings broke out there. But I do feel that some people actually got validated that they were a human being. And that what they were doing that day, somebody cared about. And when you start having that kind of habit, then maybe one of those that happens in Starbucks, or maybe one of those that happens over coffee somewhere else, or a lunch break, or in a cafeteria somewhere, turns into something more. Because one of the things that can happen out of this is that we actually begin to listen up to God, and maybe listen to a person and make eye contact, and all of a sudden, it's divine appointment on. Which is the next one I want to give you, because if you don't get past this one, you'll get stuck. Don't let my limitations, say limitations, keep me from giving something that I have in Jesus' name. Offering prayer for someone, to someone, is a powerful application of this. So Peter and John do start with their limitations. We don't have silver and gold, which is not ultimately what that guy needed the most. But what we have, we give. What they gave turned into a healing, but can I say in the most fundamental elements of it, it was simply a prayer. They stopped to pray for somebody. Did that prayer last for hours? No, it probably took seconds. And I think one of the things that oftentimes we're missing is taking a moment, and this can happen in a lot of different places, where somebody brings up a concern, it now went from work or school to personal. And if they open the door for personal, you can also open the door for personal. And you can say, could I just pray for you? And you take 15 seconds, you take 30 seconds, whatever it might be. A number of years ago, opened up my computer, and in my inbox was an email from Pat Gelsinger, who at the time was the CEO of VMware, wondering if he could come visit our church. And I knew who he was in the area, and I thought, sure, great, anybody can come to our church. And then he said, and could we go out to lunch afterwards? Sure, that would be nice. And so I got a chance, and Crystal and I got a chance to meet him and his wife, and he now is the CEO of Intel, perhaps you know that. He is like a rock star in the tech world, but he, most importantly, is a devoted follower of Jesus. Well, at the time, he came to our church and actually shared the contents of a book called The Juggling Act that he wrote a number of years ago, which talked about the balance between how do you succeed in the marketplace and how do you maintain your witness and how do you do all these things well, take care of your family, and do really the mission of God. So as Kingdom Builders, we have a ministry called Kingdom Builders. It's for marketplace leaders. And once a month, we do Kingdom Builder Monthly, and we've gone through the different chapters of the book just to keep our skills sharp. Keep learning, keep growing. It's one of the things that all of us should do. And one of the things that, two quotes out of the book. The first one was, your first witness in the workplace is being a great employee. If you don't do that, you'll diminish any level of witness that you have. Ouch. You could have said amen, but ouch is more appropriate. But then it goes on and tells this story. This is a great story. On one flight, I had a ton of work to do. As soon as the plane reached 10,000 feet, I went to work. The guy next to me, though, wanted to chat. Finally, after a number of attempts to ignore him, I gave up and thought, okay, God, I'll talk to him about you. If he's not going to let me work, he is going to hear the gospel. I love that. Too often, we're just too busy, and we don't heed the God-given appointments that he arranged for us. I am terribly guilty of this one, he says. Also, I take opportunity that the little things afford. When someone is sick, I ask, can I pray for you? He told us the story that he does this at his workplace regularly, that this is not inappropriate in the workspace that he is in, that is about as secular as any place that you can go in the Bay Area, but he finds appropriate places to get his job done and then still meet personally with people for sometimes seconds. If someone has been struggling with a divorce, come alongside of them and offer to pray for them and their children and inquire about any practical need that you might be able to help with. One coworker came to Christ in the midst of a divorce. He was delighted one day to tell me, hey, Pat, I got wet. At first, I wasn't sure what he was talking about, and then I realized he got baptized the previous week. And he and his two daughters remain on my regular prayer list to this day. There are moments that we could be interrupted that simply allow us to pray with the person, not just for a person. Sometimes to say, I'm going to pray for you is different than, can I pray for you right now? Can I meet you at the end of the day and just have a small word of prayer for you? Can I call you a little bit later and pray with you over the phone? It's powerful. But so are invitations. On your program today, there's two different invitations. One actually is to our next Kingdom Builder Monthly, where Pat Gelsinger is our guest on our Zoom call. And I'll tell you this, it is a perfect bridge opportunity for some of your coworkers who only know him as the CEO of Intel. They will be open to coming on a Zoom call to hear Pat in a non-professional setting talk about his life. He will tell his testimony about coming to Christ. He will talk about some of the things that he finds valuable from the book. And it'll be a valuable time for you and me, but more importantly, I think it's a tremendous invite opportunity. I'm going to encourage you to do this. If you work in the marketplace in any kind of way, you think of at least one coworker that you could take that information, snap that picture. We got it online so you can pick up the digital version of it too, and then send the details to at least a coworker. We have one Kingdom Builder that didn't accept the invitation to just one. He said, I'm going to send out 50. And people are responding to this and said, I'd love to come. I'd love to be a part of that. Well, as Pastor Ben said, the other one then is Easter. A Good Friday service and an Easter service are coming up. There's hard copies of invites on your way out today. Can you take several of these and then take one of them? And before we get to the response time, or as we get to the response time in a few moments, will you just ask the Lord to put in your mind who this needs to go to? You might drop it in the mail if the person doesn't immediately live right around you where you can't give it to them. Or it could be that you do what we heard earlier happen. You might want to go to somebody that lives in your neighborhood, knock on their door. Say, I know I haven't seen you for a little while, but we got something coming up. Can I give you an invite to our church? You never know if 20 years from now, somebody won't be on this stage talking about the time somebody knocked on their door and gave them an invite. That just happened earlier today, and that's an example. Well, with that said, let me give you the last one today. Mission is not only about the multitudes, often it's stopping to connect with the next one. You know, the context of the story, as I told you earlier, was chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Acts, and there is a moment in which Peter comes with the disciples out of the upper room, and there's always all these Jewish people that are very religious, and some of them start mocking, and some of them start talking, and at some point, Peter preaches, and 3,000 people give their lives to Jesus. Chapter 2. Chapter 3 is about one guy. I think that's a message right there. I think that's the other reason why, or one of the other reasons why this story is in the Bible, because most of us will not preach to a multitude of people where 3,000 people get saved on one sermon. All of us can have an encounter with the next one. Who's the next one? Because as much as Jesus ministered to the multitudes, do you know there's stories in the Bible where it was just about one person, one centurion with a sick child, one woman at a well who was more thirsty on the inside than she was just physically thirsty? There's a story about a very short tax collector who climbed up in a tree one day and Jesus said, I'm going to your house. Gave him the invitation, I'm coming to your place, but it was about one guy. Jesus got on a boat one day and crossed the Sea of Galilee to find one very tormented man who needed deliverance from the demons of his life. By the time Jesus was done with the one, the Bible says he was clothed and in his right mind because the one mattered. Jesus stopped all of heaven for you. He tells the story why? Because a good shepherd will leave 99 that are already found to go after the one. And you were the one, and I was the one, and everybody else that didn't know Jesus yet are ones. They're a whole bunch of ones. And we just need to know that God cares about the one, not just the multitudes. He died for the world. He came for the next one. I want to take that into our prayer time right now. And I'm going to ask our prayer team to come up and be ready. You can come up at the end of the service and pray for any need that you have. It doesn't have to be what I talked about today. But I do want some of us, or most of us, in the next few minutes, as the worship team leads us, to just say, Lord, I want to be tuned into mission. I don't want to just get to the end of my life and feel like I accomplished a lot of good things. I want to feel like I did what you wanted me to do. Paul would say the most important thing is that I complete my mission, the mission of sharing the good news with others. And so let's not just accomplish worldly good things. Let's not just enjoy worldly good things. Let's feel like we're on our way to heaven, taking as many people with us as we can. And I hope it gets in your heart like it's getting, just, I've always wanted our church to see more people come to Christ. I feel like it's the thing. I want it to feel like more and more, we just care the most about that. And so we have our times of prayer, we have our times of worship so that we can get ready and have our times of mission. Would you stand with me as I pray over you today? Jesus, thank you for my friends that came, are leaning in, who care about your word also, who want to be on mission. Jesus, I know that every one of us that know you as our Savior want someone else to also know you as their Savior. We don't always think about it as much, and I just pray that today, this upcoming week, all the way through Easter and beyond, it would just take a higher place in our prayer life. It would be a call from heaven right now that you want more of us to be more on mission than maybe we recently have. I also want to take a moment and pray for those of you that you came here today, and as I started the message off with, you might not even feel like you have a relationship with Jesus, but you're his mission today. You are the one. And Jesus wants a relationship with you. And I just want to pray for you today too. So Jesus, for any people that came today that don't have a relationship with you, I pray that somehow they can see themselves even in this story. They might not be physically hindered on the outside, but they know on the inside some things are not right. Maybe the word crippled on the inside could be a word that they would use to describe how they currently feel, that they're not really living the life that they want to live. They're not functioning the way they've always dreamed of functioning. Maybe that got them here today. Maybe that inner cry brought them to this beautiful gate, to this place, so they could have their divine encounter with you. So Jesus, I know that you hear them. I know that you know them. Crystal said it already at the beginning of this. God sees you, and God's inviting a group of people today to say, Jesus, come into my life. Take my sin, take my brokenness, and bring me new life. I want to surrender my life to you in Jesus' name. And then, Father, for all of us, I pray that in the days and weeks and certainly months ahead, I pray that many of us in this room would pray that prayer with someone. Literally, that we get to be the one somewhere across coffee, somewhere on a walk with a friend, somewhere in a backyard barbecue, somebody opens up their heart enough for us to be able to say, you know what? God's after you. And I just want to pray for you right now. Could I lead you in a prayer of salvation. So Lord, get us ready. Get us ready. You gave us the responsibility. Now get us ready. Help us to be filled up. Help us to be tuned in. Help us to see many people come to Christ in the next weeks ahead. I pray in Jesus' name. If you're with me on that, could you just say, Lord, let that be our cry. Let that be the sound of this church. Let it even be the heartbeat of our worship in Jesus' name.